I know a lot of people do this. When you think about like a dangerous fish in the aquarium hobby, our minds automatically go to the big guys. And for obvious reasons. I mean, these guys are big, powerful fish. They bite you. They can do a lot of damage. They can even eat fish whole. But they can't kill you, and that's what I want to talk about today. Fish in my gallery that could literally kill you. Now, for a fish to be deadly to almost anybody, it's probably gonna have to be poisonous, and if not poisonous, it's gotta be venomous, and I have an array of both out here in the gallery. We'll start with stingrays. We know that these guys are venomous. They have a spine on their tail, or a barb on their tail that they use as defense to stab and pierce a predator or when they feel in danger. Now, a lot of people know that, rest in peace, Steve Irwin was killed by a stingray. And it wasn't because the stingray was attacking him, it was defending himself. They say that they think the stingray thought that it was a large animal swimming above the shark or above the ray, and the ray stabbed him a bunch of times. Unfortunately, puncturing his chest cavity, and that caused massive trauma, killing him. If he got it in the arms or legs or any other extremities, basically, if it missed any vital organs, he'd probably still be with us today. But these guys aren't going to kill me in the aquarium hobby. They're not going to get big enough. I'm not going to give them the chance. I'm not going to be swimming in there with them. When I do have my hands in there with them, I'm respecting their distance and their space. But what happens if you get stung? Well, unfortunately, that's actually kind of common in the aquarium hobby. Lots of hobbyists have been stabbed by stingrays, so we have lots of cases and data that we can base off of knowing what will happen. Now, the stingray venom is actually protein-based, so that means it's probably going to be heat-sensitive. So if you ever are stabbed by a stingray, you want to run that under it or submerge it in as hot of water as you can handle and stand. The problem with a stingray sting is if it were to happen in the wild, there's a huge chance that this is going to become infected from the water or the barb itself. And with infection, you know, not only are you going to be in excruciating pain, but over the next few days, a fever will develop and you could potentially get sicker and sicker, and maybe even lose that limb, etc. A lot of the times though, this is happening in the lower extremities. And one of the untold stories that I always found interesting was in the Amazon. Well, for example, black diamond stingrays, only a certain amount could be imported to North America or throughout the world every year. There's a quota on certain types of fish, and black rays are one of them. With that said, the locals and fishermen, a lot of them that aren't collecting stingrays, hate the rays because the rays are getting into their fishing nets, ruining the nets, killing the fish, and worse, often they might even get stabbed or stung in their lower extremities. And when you're in a country like that and you don't have access to a lot of the healthcare and sanitation that we have, those limbs can become infected, they could lose their foot, etc. So what I heard, and I'm not sure if this is true, but when stingrays are seen by fishermen, they cut their tails off or kill the ray on sight, which kind of is heartbreaking, but I understand it. So can stingrays kill you? They could, I guess, but it would have to be a very certain set of circumstances. And one of the interesting things that we're going to be covering in today's video is that they don't have that spine to attack anybody. None of the fish are poisonous to use to kill other fish. It's all for self-defense. It's all to protect themselves. Then, of course, the anemone. We all know that these guys are venomous, but not all of them actually are that dangerous. It all kind of depends on the species. I guess I lied a little bit because the anemone doesn't sting for self-defense exclusively, but it also can do it to capture prey. So they have these stinging harpoons, which are called nematocysts, that inject a venom or a neurotoxin. Now they launch these at the slightest bit of pressure that touches them, and they use it to obviously for self-defense or to capture food. Now, if you're ever stung by an anemone, it's most likely going to be harmless. Some species will make you a little itchy, you'll get a rash, some will hurt, and then even some of the more extreme cases can potentially kill you, but that typically only happens during deep sea diving, and is not probably gonna happen in the home aquarium. Still, I'm not gonna be cuddling up with these anytime soon. But lots of other fish do. The clownfish, of course, has a symbiotic relationship with them. They secrete a mucus from their body that simulates or emulates what the tentacles are doing. So the anemones think this is just more anemone and they don't send off those little harpoons and sting the fish. So the clownfish gets protection, but the clownfish also feeds the anemone. Then there's other little fish and animals and critters that can live within the anemone. For example, the porcelain crab. They wear those anemones like little hats. They get protection, plus they're in the perfect area for food with the clownfish constantly bringing it. And they don't get stung because, well, they wouldn't feel it anyways. See, now we can get into the fish that are actually poisonous, fish that can actually kill you. We know that puffer fish in certain Asian cultures are a delicacy, but they have to be prepared by an extremely talented chef that undergone a lot of training to make sure that the fish isn't actually poisonous. You see, they have a poison within their skin, their liver, and other parts of their body, and all of that has to be removed. There's also the idea that captive bred puffer fish are not poisonous because they don't come in contact with the bacteria and algae that a lot of puffer fish consume that make them poisonous. And I don't know how much truth of that is, but what I can say is a lot of people don't like to keep wild fish, but also a lot of people don't even know they keep wild caught fish. For example, the fajaca puffer, I didn't even need to ask if it was wild caught or tank raised. They're not being bred in captivity. Obviously it is a wild caught fish. I don't think any puffer fish are actually being bred in captivity in numbers to sustain the hobby. So most, of course, will be wild caught. What happens if you eat one of these guys though? Well, we should actually probably start with just how toxic this is. Now, the poison that's found in a puffer fish is actually called tetrodotoxin, and it's 1,200 times more toxic than cyanide. Oh, before we progress, I just want to say that the reason I said liver, the poisons are found in the liver, skin, and other areas is because the other areas is their sexual organs. I'm not making that up. The fascinating thing about pufferfish that I personally find is they don't all have the same type of poison within them, and they're not all equally poison, and some just maybe and probably aren't poisonous, but there's not enough research done about it, so we can only assume. My suggestion is don't eat them, because if you do, here's what will happen to you. So within about 10 to 45 minutes after eating the pufferfish poison, you begin to feel numbness and tingliness around your mouth, salivation, nausea, and of course, vomiting. Then this may progress to paralysis, loss of consciousness, and respiratory failure, which would lead to death. So yes, the pufferfish can kill you. I have no interest in eating one, so it ain't gonna be killing me. But while we're here standing in front of this tank, of course we know that Kevin is poisonous. Kevin's poisonous. He's a good person. He's just, if you eat him, he'll poison you. He's not poisonous like a bad, he's not gonna make you a bad person. There's somebody else in this tank that is venomous, and I know some saltwater people will know exactly who it is, but a lot of fresh people won't. The fox face rabbit fish. They have venomous spines, again for defense. If something attacks them, those spines come up and they get stabbed. Now, there has been circumstances and examples of people actually getting stabbed by these guys, and they kind of all say the same thing. It really hurts. There's one fish in this tank that is pretty much the whole reason for making this video. He's not venomous and he's not poisonous, and I don't even know if it's a he. But he's the one that makes me fascinated with the evolution of fish and why they look the way they do, the shape they are, if they're venomous, poisonous, their defense mechanism, what makes them a predator, etc. And that is, where'd you go? The clown triggerfish. Absolutely ridiculous looking fish. And I almost don't want to ruin that mesmeration by Googling or looking up or studying why they look the way they look. But I'd love to hear your guys' thoughts. And why does the clownfish patterns look the way it does? There's got to be a reason. Somebody has gotten to study it in the past at some point, right? What about everybody else? So everybody else is just out of luck because they're not poisonous, venomous, they don't have spines, or they've developed in other ways. We could look at angelfish, for example, and say, how have you survived this long? You're slow moving, you're an easy target. I mean, you have big flowy fins, you're really tall and deep bodied. You got a tiny little mouth. It just makes no sense.
Right?
Well, we could say the same thing about the walru or the sevrums that are in this tank. These guys are all deep bodied, and one day those angelfish are gonna go in this tank and they're gonna fit in just perfectly because they too are deep bodied. Why though? Why are they the shape they are? Even like discus, that makes no sense, right? Well, they say these deeper bodied fish developed a morphological defense against gape-limited predators. Let me elaborate. Where the walru is from, where the sevrum is from, you know who else is from there? The Oscar, the peacock bass, the silver arowana, and what all those guys got? Big mouths. So one of the things that they've done to develop defense over time was to create a large dorsal spine and have a deep body, because those other predators can only fit so much in their mouths. It works sometimes and sometimes it doesn't, but it's allowed them to survive. You see, I don't just love fish. I love this type of information. I love trying to understand why they are the way they are, why they act the way they act, what's making them survive, how are they being so prolific, etc., etc. And I hope you guys like this too, because this is like a test video for me. I just kind of wanted to do this kind of new type of video, new type of format almost, see if you guys liked it. So if you do, give this video a thumbs up, letting me know you want more videos like this. You just want me to do a better job in the future, like make it a little more interesting, a little bit more educational, a little bit more information. Right now, I just gotta sprinkle it, see how you guys feel about it. On the note, I shouldn't bring this up. On the note of liking this video, if you like it, I want to talk about something else. In my last video, I said if this video gets 50,000 likes, I'll jump in to the pond. Right now it's at 3.6 degrees Celsius. For all you Americans there, it's about 38 degrees Fahrenheit. Let's scan around a little bit. Yeah, it's actually a nice day out. All the snow's gone, etc. The day I said I'd jump in, the pond was 1 degree. Ice cold. Let me put that into perspective. Have you ever taken a cold shower? Well, you know what the temperature of the water is if you were to do so? You see, I'm actually on a well, so the water's coming out of a really cold area. But if I measure this, it's twice as warm as the pond. Which means if I jump in that pond at that temperature, I face serious health complications, potentially. Also, all the doors in my house are snowmen. Anyways, this video did 14,000 likes. I said 50,000, so you're close. 50,000 seems like a lot, but we've done it several times on my channel in the past. Now, I'm only gonna offer this because it's the holidays, but if this video does 50,000 likes instead, I'll jump in the pond. I'm only doing this up until Christmas. After this, there's no way I'm jumping in that pond ever until the summer and it's nice and warm. But if you don't like me, get me to jump in that pond. Potentially could stop my heart. I mean, it's bitter cold and I'm gonna jump in over my head, etc. The pond is 6 feet deep. I'm only 5'9". Now you guys know I'm a midget. Bottom line is, this is gonna go over my head. Or if you could use a good laugh and you need a good Christmas present, if you guys hit 50,000 on this video or the last video or any video that I make leading up till Christmas, I better not make any good videos, I will upload a video Christmas Day jumping in that pond. And I'll probably end up deleting it the next day because that's gonna be humiliating and I might be crying in it. Who knows what's gonna happen? I don't know. I've never jumped in water that cold before. Yeah. Or don't like the video. I'll see you in the next one. Let me know if you guys like this type of video though.